Good morning all. After discussing the materials that you are supposed to deal with, today we are going to talk about the manufacturing processes. Here you will get the overall idea of the manufacturing processes. So the basic two categories of manufacturing processes, the first one is processing operations and second one is assembly operations. So processing operations in the sense, if you are altering something, that something could be shape of the object, or if you are altering property of the object, or even if you are altering appearance of the object. Okay. Either of those three, if you are altering something, that process is called as processing operation. Okay. So if you divide those processing operations further, you will get shaping processes, property enhancing processes, and surface processing operations. Shaping processes in the sense, if you are adding material, removing material, or shaping raw material into some product, those operations are shaping operations. So examples are solidification processes, particulate processing is there, solidifications like casting and all. Particulate processing is powder metallurgy, where we use metal powders, mix them with binding materials, shape into some desired object, and then heat it to get the final shape. So those are the particular processing operations. Deformation are all the metal forming processes, extrusion, bending, various forms of molding operations and all. Last one is metal removal. In case of metal removal, we take a raw material and we remove unwanted material from the surface to get the final product. The operations that are being performed on lathe machine is there, drilling machine is there, milling machine is there, and few additional processes are there. All those are the examples of metal removal processes. Now, next category is property enhancing processes. As I said, even if you are altering the properties of the material, that process falls under the manufacturing process. Examples are all the heat treatment processes that you usually carry out with metals to increase or decrease hardness. So hardening process is there. Particularly carburizing process is there to relieve the stresses generated because of hardening. You need to go for the tempering, normalizing also. All these are the examples of heat treatment processes. Then surface processing. Surface processing in the sense, the operations that are being carried out on surfaces of the object to improve their appearance or to satisfy some purpose. Like if you want to hold the object, then gripping purpose, you need to have some surface texture on the work surface, and providing that one also falls under the surface processing operations. So operations could be like cleaning and surface treatments, and even coating and deposition processes. Painting process is also example of the surface processing operations. Then the second category is assembly operations. Assembly operations are also called as manufacturing processes. Now assembly operations could be of two types. First one, joining two parts together with the help of permanent joints. And second one is mechanical fastening. Permanent joints examples are welding, brazing, soldering and adhesive bonding. All these are the examples of permanent fastening or permanent joining. Because once you join two parts together, either of those three processes, separating of those two parts going to result in damaging that workpiece. without damaging we cannot separate those two parts. So these are the examples of permanent joining, and another example is mechanical fastening. Mechanical fastening also got two types, threaded fastener and another is permanent fastening methods. Threaded fasteners are the most used examples are like fastening two parts together using the screws, nut and bolts, likewise. So where you can use that nut and bolt to hold the two parts together as per your requirement, you can separate them easily. You just need to remove that nut and bolt. And the another example is permanent fastening methods. Examples are rivetings. In case of riveting also, you can join two parts together, and that is being called as mechanical fastening. Why mechanical fastening? Because when you use rivets to hold two parts together, after the requirement, if you wish to separate those two parts, you can separate them by just damaging that rivet. Why we are calling permanent fastener? Because if you want to separate those two parts, you need to remove that rivet, and removing can be done by breaking the rivet only. So that way you can separate the part, but even that case also the parts those are held together by that rivet are not going to be damaged. So still it is example of mechanical fastening. Okay. So this slide talks about life cycle of the product. If you want to introduce some new product to the market, what stages are there that you need to follow? Either you are supposed to have an idea in your mind, or you need to go to market to have that product survey, because ultimately the user has to be the source of that information, because he is the person who is dealing with something, or that person is going to have some need or might be facing some difficulty, and for that difficulty you are supposed to offer some solution. So that survey or that first stage is going to be defining a product need and alternatives market information. Now once you have that idea or that information, the second thing or second step is conceptual design of the product. You need to design the concept, not only design, you need to evaluate that concept and go for the feasibility study. Because before launching that product into market, you are supposed to carry out this feasibility analysis also, whether that production or offering that product is feasible or not, that you need to test. Once you pass this stage, the second is design analysis. Design analysis in the sense, now you are supposed to start working on actual product, because you tested the concept and you found it okay. So now the next stage is going for the actual product. So design analysis, codes and standard reviews, physical and analytical models, all these things you need to work on. And once you are done with that design process, the second stage would be prototype generation based on the design analysis that you just have carried out. Then testing and evaluation of that prototype, and if you are succeeded in that one also, then go for the production drawing. Production drawing in the sense, the actual product that are going to be offered to the consumer, that drawings you are supposed to work on. Now once you are done with that one, then you will begin with the actual manufacturing of the product. So material specification, process and equipment selection, safety review, all these things you need to carry out before the production. Then pilot production. Pilot production in the sense, production of the actual component, but in a small lot size for the testing and evaluation purpose. After that, actual production means you are done with pilot production, you got success in that also. The next stage, actual production. So actual production would be followed by inspection and quality assurance, packaging, marketing and sales literature, and launching the product into the market. Okay, so process begins from the market survey and ends at the offering that product to the market itself. Now to summarize this one, take a look of the another sketch. You got the product idea from the market. You went for specifications, concept design, detailed design, manufacture and sale. Till then, communication is one way. Once you offer the product to the customer, you are supposed to get review if you want to be in a market, right? So after review, whatever information you have got, you will convey it to manufacturer department. If manufacturer department faces any difficulty on the in the manufacturing of the product that has been designed, they will convey it to design department. Design department will do same thing with the concept design department, and then specification and all. So from that onwards, all the departments are going to work by sharing information to and fro. Okay, so this scenario will be there if you are trying to launch some product into the market. Okay, so here we are going to stop with this introductory part, and now we are going to begin with the unit number 1. Okay, let's continue. The unit number 1 that we are going to talk about is based on the abrasive machining and finishing operations. So basically, we are going to study various processes where abrasives are used as a cutting tool that are going to be used to remove the material. And additionally, we will be talking about few finishing operations. Objectives associated with this unit. The first one, introduce the various abrasive machining processes. Then properties of the abrasives and their importance. There are certain properties associated with the abrasives that are going to play a vital role before deciding that abrasive for particular application. If you want to go for certain application, depending upon the surface properties, material removal rate and all the process performances required, you need to choose the abrasive, and that abrasive selection is going to be dependent of the properties. So that we'll be talking about. Then we'll discuss about the actual grinding process. The one of the process that is based on these abrasives is grinding. We convert that abrasives into a grinding wheel, and then grinding wheel will be used as a cutting tool. The process is grinding process. Then we'll be talking about grinding wheel and its marking system, because as I said, the abrasives are going to be shaped into some wheel, and that wheel is going to be used as a cutting tool. So for any application, to identify the wheel, we need to refer to this marking system. Next, describe grinding process and various process parameters, like performance parameters, how you are going to measure the responses of that process. That responses are nothing but the process parameters. Then when you start using the grinding wheel, obviously that wheel is going to have some wear like normal cutting tool, and to deal with that one, there are certain operations that you need to undergo. The first one is dressing, then drawing and shaping. Dressing is the operation carried out to have the fresh abrasive points on the grinding wheel surface. truing. Usually grinding wheels are going to be circular in nature, and once you start using, you may end up in some random shape of the abrasive or some large cavity here, some large cavity here, likewise, because it is going to wear, it is going to break as well. And if you want to keep it using further, you need to have it in circular shape, and converting this random shape into circular shape will be done using this truing operation. Then next one is shaping. Shaping operation will be used to shape the grinding wheel in such a way that that wheel will be used to have some desired shape on the work surface. Suppose this is raw material, and on this raw material I need to have this kind of cavity. I want to remove this much material. Now to do that, suppose I have this grinding wheel. What I'll do, I will shape this grinding wheel in such a way that if I use this grinding wheel as a cutting tool, I can easily generate this cavity. Shaping in the sense, I will remove this unwanted material and I will have a replica or similar shape on the grinding wheel first, and that wheel will be used to generate the desired shape on the work surface. Then we'll be talking about various grinding operations and design considerations in grinding. If you want to go for grinding operation, what considerations are there that you need to follow? Then last one, we'll be talking about the surface finishing operations. As I mentioned earlier, in addition to grinding, there are certain finishing operations, and we are going to talk about those operations in detail. Next, introduction to abrasive machining. Abrasive machining is among the final steps of production of the part. Why is this? Because if you look at the nature of abrasive machining process, is the abrasive machining processes are employed when the accuracy and surface roughness, the first thing is accuracy and second thing is surface roughness, when those two things are required to be as fine as possible, the accuracy requirement and surface roughness. When you want to have a fine surface, surface roughness value should be as minimum as possible, and accuracy in the sense dimensional tolerances are as close as the final product. If you want these two characteristics in the product, then you can go for the abrasive machining processes. Now to have those two operations, it is but obvious that the material removal rate has to be ignored at some point, because to have those two characteristics, the material removal value is obviously going to be at the lower side. Okay, so because of these characteristics, abrasive machining processes are usually carried out at the end of the production, means when product is almost has reached the final dimensions, and now you need to remove a small layer from the work surface to maintain the accuracy and surface finish, then you can go for these operations. Now what are their capabilities? Capabilities are, you can have dimensional tolerance less than 1 micron, so the deviation between the actual product and the design product could be as close as 1 micron, and surface finish could be as fine as 0.025 micron. So that much surface roughness value you can get with the abrasive machining processes. Now these abrasive machining processes are basically has two modes. First one is where you get those abrasives and put them on some supporting surface, like making grinding wheel or putting it on a paper or putting it on a cloth, and then using that cloth, paper or wheel as a tool. These operations are called as bonded or coated abrasives. And in another scenario where we use abrasives in a free form, the abrasives in a powdered form itself are used as a cutting tool. The operations are ultrasonic machining, lapping, abrasive flow machining, etc. In these 3-4 examples, abrasives are not supported by any other material and those are directly in a powder form used as a cutting tool. Now what are the typical parts made by the abrasive machining processes? The typical parts made are going to be have maximum accuracy and minimum surface finish. Minimum surface finish in the sense surface finish is as fine as possible. Surface roughness value has to be minimum. So typical parts made are ball and roller bearings, piston rings, valves, cams, gears, tools and dies. Now if you have looked at these parts, you can easily understand that the surface finish in all those parts is almost as good as mirror's finish. And if such a finish is required, abrasive machining processes are the examples of the processes where you can get those kind of surface characteristics. Now what are the alternative processes? Obviously there has to be some alternative also. So the alternative processes are electrical discharge machining, electrochemical machining, etc. These are the examples of non-traditional machining or non-conventional machining. So if you want to replace those abrasive machining processes, you need to go for these non-traditional machining processes that can produce similar kind of the surfaces. Abrasives, these are small and hard particles having sharp edges but irregular in shape. Unlike single point cutting tool, where the cutting tool has a geometry where all the surfaces have certain angles, right? All the surfaces are having some inclinations with each other. So that kind of scenario will not be here. The particles are going to have irregular shapes. And those irregular shaped small and hard particles will be used as a cutting tools. Those are going to be hard enough so that can be used as a cutting tool. So those abrasives would be capable of removing a small amount of material from the surface through cutting process. As abrasive itself is a small particle, when you use that abrasive as a cutting tool, it is but obvious that the chips formed by that particle are going to be even smaller. So the materials are going to be removed in the form of small chips. Now abrasives, you could find them in nature also, and you can produce them synthetically also. In nature, the abrasives you can get in emery, corundum, also called as alumina, quartz, garnet and diamond form. These are the examples of the abrasives that you can get in nature. Diamond you can get in both forms. Diamonds can manufacture synthetically also. Now these natural abrasives are going to have some impurities. Those are not going to be in a pure form, and if you use them as a cutting tool, because of the impurities present in those abrasives, the machining performance is going to be inconsistent and unreliable, because you will not be sure about the performance by that abrasive particle, because impurities are there that are randomly spreaded. So when, where, how that particle is going to work, we will not sure about that one. So to avoid this one, you can manufacture abrasives synthetically also. And the examples are conventional and super abrasive. Examples of conventional are aluminum oxide, alumina, or silicon carbide, and super abrasives are CBN, cubic boron nitride, and diamond. The properties, if you compare between conventional and super abrasives are going to have better properties compared to conventional one, and even cost of super abrasives are going to be more compared to conventional abrasives.